You may be Wednesday for the reading of God's Word today. We're going to read Romans 9, 19 to 29 today. Romans 9, 19 to 29. It says, "You will say to me then, why does God still find fault? For who can resist his will? But who are you, O man, to answer back to God? Well, what is molded say to its molder? Why have you made him like this? Has the potter no right over the clay to make out the same lump, one vessel for honorable use and another for dishonorable use? What if God, as I show his wrath, and make his own his power, has endured with much patience vessels of wrath prepared for destruction, in order to make known the riches of his glory for vessels of mercy, which he has prepared beforehand for the glory? Even us, whom he has called, not from the Jews only, but also from the Gentiles. As indeed he said in Hosea, those who are not my people, I will call my people, and her who is not my beloved, I will call beloved. And in the very place where it said to them, you are not my people, there will be called sons of the living God. And Isaiah cries out concerning Israel, though the number of the sons of Israel be as the sand of the sea, only a remnant of them, only a remnant of them will be saved. For the Lord will carry out his sentence upon the earth fully, will not delay. And as Isaiah predicted, if the Lord of hosts had not left his offspring, who would have become, would have been made like the Sodom and like Gomorrah. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. May you see. In this section, we are almost wrapping up Romans chapter 9. Paul is offering up responses to objections to the doctrine of election. And the doctrine of election in this context, in this letter, fits in discussion of the covenant of grace. Alright? So many years ago, God entered into a covenant of grace with Abraham. And Abraham believed God, and it said that he was counted as righteous. And this is the same gospel that you and I have, is that when we believe in the Lord and his word, he says to us, trust him, he counts us as righteous. It's not who we are in ourselves, but it's a righteousness that comes from outside of us and is credited to us. It's not who we are in ourselves, it's a status you receive. This is the gospel. It's a righteousness which comes from God, as Romans 1, 16, 17 teaches. And so how does that, how does sinners, how are they declared righteous? That's the gospel. It's the good news of what Jesus accomplished, and then applied to us by the Spirit, which we embrace. As you see, though, we are not in the condition of perfect righteousness in ourselves. We struggle with sin. We have a lot of work to do to value sin and live under righteousness. So we, like all believers, struggle with appropriate promises. And so when Paul finished speaking of sanctifications in chapter 8, he moved into the hands of the objection. What about Israel? He's given us a great doctrine to think about sanctification. If you have a doctrine to think about what anybody needs at all, what do we think about the meaning of life and where do we come from? What is the meaning of history? And seminary, I talk about professors and speak about church history. They came with people and his story. The history is his story, right? That's the thing about when we think about God. God works in all things, we believe this, but that everything we encounter is his story. And his story is ongoing. So if you want to think about it, consider how it is in history. History cannot be rightly understood apart from it being understood as God's story, his story. This really first Paul's going to respond to the person who does not trust God. This is not an honest question. This is a question from a scholar. It says, well, why would you still find fault then? It's a doctrine of election too. Now, one of the doctrine of election is that God controls salvation. He determined, he chose, and he said, and he decided, not to save others. And you see that as examined this doctrine, you spoke about, well, what happened to Israel? Well, it's not all this is Israel. Okay? Jacob and Rebecca, they had two children. Isaac and Rebecca, two children, Jacob and Esau, had the same father before they were born. God loved Jacob, and he hated Esau. You consider that. Like, well, that's not fair, right? You can't do anything to deserve this. Well, what God's doing is everyone's sin. Everyone's dead. Everyone's sin. Everyone's in love. And so when God speaks about hardened fair repentance, he's taking what's already there and molding it into further rebellion. But what's unique is those that do not dwell, that do trust God and follow them, that's an act of mercy. It's undeserved. Something that we need to understand. There's no such thing as deservedness. It's all paradox. If we can merit or see a deserved passage. So, what has perspective here on someone who's asking a question like that? Someone who's saying, well, who can resist his will? How can God judge it? I'm just doing what he's made me do, right? God doesn't need us, right? He doesn't need us to understand him, but he condescends to us to help us. Or ultimately, for our benefit. So we can look at him and say, that's who our God is. We can be assured he is and love him more for our sakes. He's going to reveal who he is today, not for his sake, but for our sake, because he's most merciful for us. So, as we're considering this, why would God judge Pharaoh? Why would he judge Esau? Why would he judge those who reject him? Right? Because he's raising them up to be trying to do them. Why would say, well, they're doing exactly what I want to do? Right? God raised them up, it says in his text, that he might declare his glories to the vessels of mercy. He's not a narcissist. God isn't. He lacks nothing. He doesn't need our worship. He doesn't need our adoration to meet his needs. He has no needs. But the judgment of Pharaoh is transmission of that news, that Pharaoh had rose to divine creator, and the creator drowned that with the king in the Red Sea. That news went out to the nations, and they glorified God, and they're still to themselves and read the story. That's what the world needs. It's not what God needs. God's sufficient in himself. He wants to make the vessel of his mercy know the glories. In a world to reject God, God's engineering history to rain down that message on the head of all who is there. That God is full of mercy for those of us, but he is full of wrath for any who will stand against him. So he is. He's righteous. He's just. He must be so. He never contradicts himself. God's engineering history so that we would have this message, and anyone who has ears to hear it, will hear it. And that history truly is his story. If you're trying to think about what is history, the story of God in the world at work, in order to reveal who he is to those who love us, who love him. God's revealing who he is to the events of history to those who love us, who he is. That's the thesis today. If we have any other definition of history, three revisions. If God reveals himself in his story, then God can love him, know him, and bless him. And we have to know him. So that's it. Our first point, the amazing question here, is that Paul is going to help us to look at, expecting on who we are and who God is. The first thing is, let's look at this in verse 2. What applies this? That, why does God judge that question? The answer is, well, who are you? You start asking that questions. Is God God? Let's ask perspective. Who are you, O man? The answer back to God, verse 1 says. The answer, have a perspective. Who do you think you are? Who are you talking to? You have no awareness of who you're speaking about. Who is you? It's the first one you've got to know is that you are created. You and I are eternal. You and I are all from mother and father. And our mothers and fathers are not plural. They had a mother and father. So, they had a point where they were not people. And there was a point where there were no people at all. People had a den. And from where did they, human beings, go? Where did we come from? How do these organic, complex, rational creatures who can build skyscrapers, who can send people into outer space, and back then who can write poetry and love songs, how can we, have we arrived? Where do we come from? How can we, to be like a little bit of knowledge, right? Just an insane piece of athleticism. How many soldiers can run as fast as 28 miles per hour? How are these marvel visions of human engineering? Where did they come? Did they just suddenly emerge this slime that non-matter? Where did that come from? From where did our planet and our solar system and our universe come from? It's eternal. It's not, it's eternal. It can't be eternal. It can't have a beginning, right? So only sufficient explanation for why anything is here. The things that you are experiencing right now, why are they here? Is because God, Jesus Christ, dreamed them up and said, let them be, and they were. That's the only explanation. God spoke in existence. An eternal, wise person made all that we know to be happy and true. He said, let them be, and there it was. And that is the beginning of history. But God did not just wind up creation and depart and say, let it wind up. No. He didn't just leave it behind. Creation is developing according to God's purpose and His pleasure. That's the doctrine of election. So from the beginning and eternity, God has a doctrine of election. He says, we're chosen, we're called according to His purpose in verse 11. Now, He's working that out in time. History is moving toward the fulfillment of His election. So God, the Creator, is building history out of His eternal blueprints. He has a blueprint, and what we're experiencing now is the building up of that history. All history arose from the Creator and God, who gives it purpose and gives it meaning. And He will carry on His own fulfillment of purpose and meaning. I thought this is kind of basic stuff, right? If this is something you don't hear of it, this I had not done here today, that this is history. This is what history means. Right? So, God created life. Can you create life? Who are you on that history of God? That's what Paul's getting at. Who are you that cast objections towards God when He's doing it in history? Can you create life? No. I have a secondary means of creating life. Knox, Owen, Briggs, and Lily. I'm not sure. I have a secondary means. But God creates it. Right? I can't help make that. Who do I think I am? This is His story, not me. So, if we're thinking about how tall our kids are going to be, every grade that they're ever going to make on the test, what they're going to enjoy, eating and drinking, everything about them, these things are designed according to God's design. And it's different. Every child is designed according to God's design and His purposes. That's who God is. His story, not mine. So when we know, we can know absolutely nothing if we don't start there. We've got to start from election. This is the very precondition of having true knowledge itself. We have to know that God has a blueprint and He's working it out with His purposes and His story. And work out His reputation. If I was made, then why was I made? Does God have a plan in our life? A wonderful plan in our life. And how would I know that, if that's true? And to reveal that to you, can I bank on that? But our bulletin today, as Deuteronomy 29:29, it says that the secret things belong to the Lord, our God. The things that are revealed belong to us and our children forever. We all worship the law. So these revealed things are your possession. They're treasures to you. If you have what God has revealed about Himself and about history, that's a treasure that not everyone knows. The secret things, as far as what your future is going to be and all the details of how it's going to shake out, those things are God's. have not been revealed to you. But what has been revealed in His Word is yours. It's yours to cherish and know. Every ancient hearer would look at this text, the reader's here, and say, well, okay, I see that. And it says, who are you, O man, to answer back to God this way? And he follows up that question with, he follows his question, why is God not my fault? Another question, who are you to answer back, right? And he says, another question, well, what is molded, as he puts molder, why have you made me like this? Now, everyone who comes to hand here, they're going to think about pottery and potters. And they're going to think these potters manufacture basic household containers for cooking. And when these containers are broken, these pieces can be utilized as notes, scraps for trying out notes. These pottery is a big part of life in the ancient world. So the potter is an artist. He's a scientist. It's hard work to create pots and mold them, right? So it takes a lot of work, and a potter would presumably have a plan when he sets out to create a vessel, and he would work that vessel according to his purposes, right? And he has various different methods, and I won't go into all the details of how the potter is made, and you can look that up in books and I don't understand how it was, but the idea is that Paul uses his language to think about what's something that everyone kind of knows about to express the absurdity of us questioning God. Pottery or clay, not look at this potter and ask a question. Right? So that's the situation. God himself is called the potter, and we are called the clay in Isaiah 64:14. You see that he uses that same word for pottery in the Old Testament for the forming of our hearts. God is the potter who forms our hearts. He forms even the spirit of humans, as Psalm 32:15 says. But the key text, I think, for looking this up is the Isaiah 64:8 passage says, now, O Lord, you are our Father, you are the clay, and you are the potter. We are the work of your hand. That is an image that is in the minds of the hearers. That's an image of someone who is at work in the world, a potter. And so, we don't have a lot of pottery going on around this conference room every day. But we can understand that. I'll tell you what. What about Legos? Okay? The next big invention in our world, nervous, is talking Legos. Right? Talking legs. For the longest time, legs have been something that's been inanimate, no verbalness at all. You step on them, you know, they're all looking like the ceiling, they hurt your feet. They're left behind, kids playing with them. But legs are a great tool of joy that you can create, to build things. There's a form of room for our church, but I think they actually stayed with us one summer. And I just moved on now, but 2 years ago, he stayed with us in the summer. And Wes Pittman is a grown man who loves Legos. He builds up and gives a great ability to put together Legos to create something awesome. So he inspired my children to actually build more and to get better at building Legos. We enjoyed having him here. So he would come up with a plan, a vision of what he wanted to make. He would gather the appropriate parts and look and search for the right ones. And he would snap them all together. That's how it works. And then once you snap them all together, you have completed a product. And so never did we hear the end talk about it that said, Wes, I'm about this plane situation, Germany. Maybe you should have done it a car at the time. So it never said that. It never spoke back to them, right? Now, Legos don't speak to the builder. This is clay doesn't speak to talk, right? Legos that talk don't exist, but it talks does not exist. Sinners talk back to God, the rational. It's like a Lego that speaks. It's like a clay that speaks to the Father. You know, never do you think less to look at, like, are you going out? You made an airplane, maybe the airplane, you convince them to switch up and demolish and turn the car. He's nice. He's going out. But this is God we're talking about here. He's full of mercy, but he has a plan. And our calling is to trust that plan. Now, we're not in a God. We're not building a church. We are in a church of God. We're able to reason and said, write poetry, love songs, and tradition. We do. You know, what Paul's saying here is that though we are gifted and endowed with these abilities, we have no right to use those abilities to question the beauty of God. It's what we are. We have no right to do that. Who do we think we are to speak against our Maker, who forms us however he wills? Now, what Paul's saying here is that sometimes in cases like Pharaoh, God will demonstrate a lot of patience. You know, he decreed that man would be born 1,500 years before the birth of Jesus in Egypt. And a little son would be to take the nation of Egypt and all of their power as this ancient powerhouse and down to the Nile River for the feast of the nation. And then he formed this empire. And that God would speak audibly to Abraham 500 years before this Pharaoh's birth, and get Abraham and his great grandchildren to Egypt. And if this great grandchildren of Abraham would become this numerous threat to Pharaoh, and that God would miraculously put Moses in the house of Pharaoh, and Pharaoh would be raising his great point and protecting him, and that Moses would murder someone, and that Moses would be led in the wilderness for 40 years. To be prepared to be a shepherd, a prophet, and defend his people, and set them free, right? He'd be built up for his task. And if he would stand before Pharaoh and his brother Aaron, and they would call Pharaoh to let people go, and Pharaoh would start to capitulate and he'd turn every time. After 10 signs, miraculous signs, Pharaoh never would obey God. With great patience, God raised up this man to demonstrate to his vessels of mercy the glories of the merciful one. As Pharaoh was drowned in the Red Sea, and people saw the sovereignty of God, why is it that God gave us? We were the slaves in a foreign country, and God sets us free. Why would we do this? Why would Pharaoh behave in such a manner that God would favor us over him? When I was in Israel, I had the opportunity to purchase a necklace for my wife. It's a turquoise glass fragment on it from a Roman architect, Roman city. And I thought that was a really interesting artifact, right? And the artifact speaks to his story. Now, Rome was raised up according to Daniel and Revelation. Lord of the church. He was going to oppose Jesus. And that shattered glass wore on the neck of my life as a decoration. So the great appropriate decoration for one of God's children in 2022 in the middle of the USA as a message to a vessel of mercy to the riches of his glory. The same nation that rejected Jesus, crucified him, was defeated in two ways by God in his story. Number one, it was a real fear of shattered, 4th century God of Jesus. But it was also spiritually shattered in Paul's hands. Paul himself belongs to this and became a leader of Jesus, crucified, born of Rome on the third day. Their citizens turned away from their idolatry and emperor worship and adoration, and spoke to Jesus and trusted him above any other glories of the glories. Jesus, who had died and rose on the third day, was foolishness to Romans, right? For the Romans had been transformed from inside out, and God triumphed. This fragment of an empire in the last month, where the neck is a picture of God's victory over this crushing empire that built up their entire on killing Christians and trying to suppress Jesus. His word is not suppressed. His word is not for him to go along to all nations. His spirit has been bringing the gospel of Jesus Christ to sinners and transforming them because we are vessels of his mercy. And thus is the wrath we need to consider. And thus the mercy we need to consider. Who are we? What are we? What has God made us to be? Because the final point is that his scope is the fulfillment of salvation by God's grace, described in advance by Hosea and Isaiah in the 8th century BC. What it says there is no one will believe that there would be so many people who would know God, right? And that they would be rebels against God. It says there in verse 23, it says, God raised up these vessels of mercy. We're going to raise these people up so the vessels of mercy should appear beforehand with notice. And it says, verse 24, even us, he is called, not from the Jews, but also from the Gentiles. He says he's called Jew and Gentile to believe in this, to be vessels of mercy. But prior to this, in the 8th century BC, he rose up a prophet to the northern kingdom division, the northern kingdom division, the 10 tribes of the north. Hosea spoke to them in the late 8th century BC. He was given a task to tell them about Assyria. Tell them that you are going to be cast into exile, run out of the land, because of your idolatry, because you behave like a harlot. And what are you going to tell them? You're going to tell them and you're going to harlot. You're going to marry a harlot. You're going to have children. You're going to name them things like no mercy. You're going to name them things like not my people. To demonstrate that they have been kicked out of, they have not only become grace, they have been removed from. They've become Latin nations. Now, Isaiah is going to tell the people down south, in Jerusalem, Judah, and Benjamin, that you too have to worry about this too. Babylon will come to take you away into exile. But here's the thing, it says in Isaiah that you are going to be, though it says, though you're numerous, but it's going to see a remnant will be saved. Only a remnant will be saved. A small group will be saved. By right? Hearing brought back from Babylon, and the Lord's going to carry you into the land as he's carrying out the sentence of justice on Babylon. He's going to carry you back to Jerusalem, here in the field. And 500 years later, you know what's going to happen? Another vessel is going to come. A vessel of God's wrath. Jesus. Jesus is going to be born of one of these descendants of the remnant, Mary, in a hill country town in Nazareth. And he's going to be raised, and he's going to go into Jerusalem. And he is going to become a vessel of wrath. He is going to be crushed for the sins of his vessels of mercy. That in his being crushed, you and I will be redeemed. We will be recipients of his mercy. On his resurrection. He is crushed. He is shattered as a vessel of wrath. All the wrath of God is poured out on Jesus Christ. And he dies on a cross outside the city of Jerusalem as a vessel of wrath. In a way that Pharaoh had no idea. Jesus became a vessel of wrath for the sake of his vessels of mercy. That he can truly become a vessel of mercy. He's thinking about, well, how is God going to show favor on some and not others? How's he going to be a remnant of that? How's Mary going to do that? Well, it's because of Jesus. They were declared righteous in advance because of the work of Christ, but before them. They were righteous. Mary was righteous. You are righteous. You are a vessel of mercy. And he declares his glory, not for us and most in the destruction of Pharaoh, but in the destruction of the Son of God, the Creator. He was destroyed in my work. He is the vessel of mercy that you need. There is no salvation apart from his story. And his story is the unfolding of that story to nations and peoples that far outstrip where Paul was. Paul was part of this. We are part of this. We're part of his story. All of us are in faith in Jesus. And that's the will of God, that Jesus became a vessel of wrath and a vessel of mercy. That's the surprising fact of the gospel. is that there's no way God can legitimately declare any of us to be his people, any of us to be vessels of mercy, without justice. He bore the justice on the cross. Jesus became the ultimate vessel of wrath, formed to bear eternal death on the cross outside Jerusalem, and died under God's curse for sin. He would be the vessel of mercy. He would rise and teach and commission the apostles to go to the nations with a message to people for them to hear and believe. And the Holy Spirit would be sent to communicate God's mercy to those, one at a time, as they transport from being children of wrath to children of mercy. I want to end by reading to you from Ephesians chapter 2, verses 1 and following. Give these words in Ephesians 2, 1 and following. It says, "You were dead in trespasses and in which you once walked, following the course of the world, following the prince of power here, the spirit that is now working for sons of disobedience. You were dead, among whom we all live in this, after the passion of our flesh, caring, desire of the body, and the mind, and the children of wrath of the rest of mankind. But God, in his mercy, because of his great love, it says, by grace we have been saved. He made us alive together with Christ, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. In the coming ages, he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness to us in Christ Jesus." That's exactly what he said all the time. He's going to show the vessel of mercy, his riches, and his glory, right? He does this in the cross of Christ. Rising from the dead, it says, "For by grace you've been saved through faith." And this is not your own doing, it's the gift of God. Not his own works, but no one knows. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in him. So what's going on here? God is not some doubts from heaven, arbitrary and saying, "Hey, you want to get in? You can't get in, so you're not on the list." Look, no one will be on the list if you didn't transfer us from being vessels of wrath to being vessels of mercy through the grace of the Lord Jesus. God brings people to heaven who want to be there. He brings people to faith who want to be there because they've been born again. He gives you a choice, and you can choose nothing else. He says, "You know him. You know what Jesus did for you. It's your story. And you embrace him." That's how you came with one, a vessel of mercy, by his choice and his application of it to you. Now, he says, if it weren't that, we become like Solomon and Noah. We'd be nothing but us. God does this. He answers the prophecies that God will make for them. God will do this. Otherwise, we'll be like Solomon and Noah. We'll be wiped out. Out of Solomon and Noah, only 3 people survived. Who? Lot and 2 daughters. Is it because they are righteous? No. Because Abraham prayed and said, "Don't let the righteous be forsaken among the wicked." They don't rise themselves. No, they don't rise in Christ. Jesus comes to them. We are either clothed in our own rags of wickedness or clothed in the righteousness of Christ. Lot and his daughters were by mercy and grace clothed in the righteousness of those of Christ. That's what happens. So this is the death of any spiritual conscience that they have. I had the opportunity to take two of my boys out and drive them together. I have 15 people trying to think about driving. It was awesome to see them. I don't make a call for the first time, right? All of them for the first time. At the last time together, God had not struck the car garage. And his words were, "That thing is better than you." I said, "That's cute." So you cannot be better than me. I've been with you 27 years. I still don't even know how to drive. Isn't that funny? We get a little taste of experience, and we think, "Man, I'm good. I'm better than anybody I've done this for." We're not there. None of us are. Especially not a rookie driver, parked car on time to drive. I do every day. The good of it was in me. So that's eternal. You're not going to outthink him, outwit him, outplay him. He knows what he's doing. Thank the Lord he does. And it brings me very close to say, "I don't lie. He's the creator, he's the sustainer, not you." And we know that he's got a wise plan. If you look at how he did Christ, look at how he saved us, look at how he will save us. All right, let's take a moment and pray.